So this is a wonderful interview that I'm going to be sharing with you that is going to be all about helping to us to learn more about diversity in leadership. So I want to share a little bit about that diversity in leadership and see how we can... I'm not going to be able to share that. I wanted to share it on the screen. But what I wanted to talk about is what exactly is Leadership in Diversity. It's a beautiful organization that is coming together to teach us how we can work together in all different industries. And so I have my beautiful guest here, Megan. I would love for you to... share a little bit about the background and the story behind how this beautiful mission got started for you, a little bit about you, and why are you so passionate about this message and helping to bring this message to the masses. Thank you so much for being here, and welcome to Harmony Week here on Spirituality Gone Wild.
Thank you so much, Karen, for having me. Well, Leadership for Diversity is basically a collective work, a mutual mentor network across industries. And we're like a gang for good, championing leadership for the greater good. And the idea behind it is basically this. We all have unconscious bias. The funny thing about God is, he knows that I can see your blind spots, but you can't, and vice versa. So why not support each other to make the transition from the head, leading with the head, to leading with our hearts together? And so the idea of all of us making this journey, which is sometimes painful, you know, to uncover blind spots that, you know, in this current culture, we've been taught to that we can't really bring our whole selves to work. We kind of have to put on our armor and look as if we have it all together. So the idea for Leadership for Diversity, which is really Leadership for Humanity, is bringing our full selves to the table. Anywhere we go, vulnerability is our strength, and we've been taught that that's weak and our emotions are weak. Basically, we need to be operating with our full human potential. And John Cleese, he has this quote that says, creativity is not a skill, it is our operating system. And I believe that creativity is our human operating system, because it accesses all domains of knowing for good sake. It is our creative intelligence and our analytical intelligence. It's our masculine and our feminine.
And how did you come to this, Megan? How did you come to this realization? And what is the way that you... spend your days working on this project? I would love to hear just a little bit more about your background and how you were led into this beautiful movement.
Well, the past few years for all of us have been a wake-up call, and I certainly got mine. I was a filmmaker. That's how I started out. I worked as a producer and an editor for documentary and corporate and educational films and videos. And then I got interested in multimedia, nonlinear medium, that started in Seattle. And so I actually moved from DC to Seattle without a job when I was in my 30s. And I thought it was a great opportunity to be able to tell stories about the power and brilliance of women and the multi dimensions versus the stupid stereotypes they keep feeding us. And then when I got here, I was like, wow, what have I done? Because I wasn't sure how to go about that. But it led to a brief couple years at Microsoft, which taught me a lot. And then to a company called Her Interactive that was creating a video game for girls with the Nancy Drew franchise. And I knew nothing about video games. I loved Nancy Drew. She was my idol, as many women adored her and still do. And it was a story, and I'm a storyteller, and I just thought that could be such a great way to inspire girls to do the impossible. And so I came on as creative director and was there for the first, we created the first game together and had a ball doing it, people from diverse backgrounds, which was different from film. So we didn't necessarily speak each other's language, but we were all in it together to kind of that collective intelligence. And we blended education and entertainment in such a non-spinachy way that it served to inspire a lot of girls to go on to become scientists and detectives and lawyers and such. And so then we took the game to the publishers to get it on the retail shelves, and they said, oh, I'm sorry, but girls and women are computer phobic. We're not gonna take your game. And this was 98. I was stunned, but I knew they were crazy because, you know, it's half the population and this is an emerging medium and it's all about playing. So why would we exclude half of the population? Females. Anyway, a month later, the CEO stood up at a board meeting and resigned, and they looked at me and said, we think you can do it. And that's how I became CEO.
Wow, what a great story. What an amazing, amazing journey. And what a blessing you are to the world to take all of these beautiful, beautiful gifts that you have and put them all together. And it's almost like a beautiful crystal ball of the future, what's possible. You know, just looking in that crystal ball and saying, this is possible for women and girls. This could be, you know, looking at it back in 1998, I'm sure people were going, wait a minute, you know, 1998, a lot of people weren't thinking that somebody, you know, could have this kind of vision. And what I've always been told through, you know, my spiritual guides and the angels is that we sometimes as humans have to grow in to the vision. They give us these beautiful big visions, divine ideas, divine inspiration comes through us. And we are so blessed that it's in our heart and we feel it and we can feel it and we can actually start to notice it happening. And then our human self, our human little self, has to grow a little bit to get to that. So I love this. This is such a beautiful journey. Thank you so much for sharing it.
Well, you know, it's a collective vision. It wasn't my vision. It was a game with, you know, for girls, which seems so obvious. And we all, the whole team, you know, we were in it together. And it was a really amazing co-creation. And it felt like play because we were leading in the moment. We were coming from our hearts, and it was just an extraordinary experience. And I feel so honored to have had it. And we went on to actually defy the odds because while no one believed in us, we did. And since we didn't have to follow these rules that made no sense whatsoever, we redesigned the system. And we found someone at Amazon to teach us how to publish on Amazon, which was a tiny little startup at the time.
Wow.
And so the game sales took off, and that's when the publishers came back to offer us a deal in retail, and that's when we began to take off. So, and the other thing I didn't mention is I had no formal financial, technical, or management skills whatsoever. I stayed away from corporations my whole life because I inherently knew that they didn't respect women or creativity. So I was entirely unconventional. But it actually served me well for a while at least. And we had a decade of success, and then the economy crashed, and that's when I crashed, and that was my wake-up call that has really led me to what I'm doing now. And Leadership for Diversity is one of the projects that I'm working on. But I fell into fear. So many things happened simultaneously, and I didn't have the skills, nor did I have the people on board. And that was one of my many learnings, to pivot the company to help me do that. So it was too little too late, and I became a part from instead of a part of the team. And that was such an uncomfortable feeling. And I didn't know how to get myself back. I lost myself. So that led me to meditation. And it actually led me to 4 years of multidisciplinary research in the areas of creativity and emotional and conversational intelligence and quantum physics and spirituality and ancient wisdom. On and on, because the dots kept connecting. I thought it was just going to be a little bit of research. And the two questions I had were that led me to do this. I was so curious, why aren't we leading with our hearts, our creative intelligence? And how do we stay in our hearts when fear consumes us? So I started out selfishly because I wanted to get back, but you know, realized that we're all in this together. You know, none of us are doing it completely on purpose. We have a lot of, you know, we're asleep in many ways. And, you know, due to how society, how, you know, authority, righteous authority is telling us how to think, act, and behave. So this opened up so many doors for me in terms of my awareness. And I started calling the multidisciplinary experts because I just loved their books, and they were expanding my awareness and realized how we are all unfolding at different ways, but it's all about sharing our wisdom and our experiences and our stories. And then Gamergate happened in the gaming industry, and I'm not sure whether your viewers are familiar with that, but basically it started with some men on the internet harassing any woman in the gaming industry who spoke out for diverse leadership or diverse content. And it got really serious. They threatened to kill them and to rape them. And two women were chased out of their homes, and the FBI got involved. And so this was, you know, such a wake-up call for the gaming industry. And at that time, I thought, well, I designed a creative leadership summit kind of in response for senior executives to gather with these multidisciplinary thought leaders to help expand perspectives, to help them think differently, to start behaving differently. And that eventually led to Leadership for Diversity, which basically I just changed the branding last year when Trump was elected. And it sort of took off in July, creating this community basically where we can all come together.
We're stronger together. We're brighter together.
Why do it alone?
There's no need for it.
Right. And so it's, you know, sense of humor is in play. You have, you know, colleagues to call when you didn't have such a good day or you really weren't in your best possible self. And they can help to kind of get you back. You don't need to be any, you know, you're at the stage you are. And we're all growing at different levels. And it's really helped to expand compassion, which is the underlying piece to all of this. And the reason why John and I at Compassion Games in summer, we started partnering together.
Tell me a little bit about that. How did you guys end up starting to be partners? And how did that start to unfold for you?
Well, a mutual friend introduced John and I and said, look, you both are basically promoting love and action to, you know, lead with our best possible selves. And so he introduced us, and we're both in Seattle. And we immediately hit it off and talked about how we can support each other. And I think
here we are on Harmony Week, and Summer brought us together. So I'm so grateful. Summer and John are so amazing, and we're so blessed. Spirituality Gone Wild and myself were champions of compassion, and we were passed the torch. And I passed the torch on to an organization that I work with called We the World.
Yes.
And, so we are, you know, just continually co-creating. My latest book was Co-Creating Heaven on Earth and How to Believe in Kindness Again. So how to believe in kindness again is, to me, what you're doing. You know, it's really what you're living is this love in action experience, and really just taking this diversity into leadership, into all different arenas. And that is so beautiful.
Well, I think we're all leaders.
Yeah.
That's kind of the other myth or lie, that only the ones, you know, with the roles or the titles. We all have our unique way of leading when we're when we have the courage to come alive, to bring our full selves. And the other piece is, you know, this beautiful Compassion Torch ceremony, and I'm so glad you were honored, and I'm so happy that I've met you. It's such a sacred ceremony, and we don't honor each other enough.
We really don't.
We don't, you know, and John and I, we were in France together, introducing Compassion Games and Leadership for Diversity at DigiWorld together, and we got to know each other because we'd only met each other on Skype, and 2 weeks later, we're off to France. It was great. And he said, I'd like to pass you the torch for being a leader for diversity, and I said, great. I didn't really know what it was all about, but it was such a beautiful ceremony, and so after I said, you know, John, since we're supporting each other, why not extend this ceremony into the gaming industry and also honor people in Seattle, these leaders doing this great work, to literally shine the light, because we're hearing so much about the lack of diversity, but if we can see it, we can be it. And so we started doing that 2 weeks ago and honored 20 people. And so we're posting them to social media, and it's really had such a positive effect. It's early, but already a lot of colleagues have been like, wow, it's so great to hear from the heart people's stories and what unique contributions they're making, and that they are not only taking a stand for diversity, meaning diverse thinking, not only, you know, racially or culturally, it's about everything. It's about opening our hearts to lead with our hearts. Which is completely flipping it upside down from how the world has functioned since the beginning. But, you know, Leadership for Diversity, the criteria for joining is basically committing to becoming a better leader and supporting each other in the process.
Yeah.
And then on the site, there's a repository of inspiring leadership resources like mindful techniques, TED Talks, multidisciplinary books that basically help us to navigate the inner space.
Yeah.
and lead from within, which is, you know, the work that you're doing, and I'm learning. You know, we've only known each other a week, and I've learned so much already. But that is, it's the subtle energies that we are now collectively and individually learning how to master to stay in our light, right?
Yeah. So now, Megan, if I were to give you a magic wand, and I were to just say, here, Megan, here's your magic wand, what would be the best possible outcome that you could see in the next 6 months?
Just globally? Whatever. Okay, twofold. One, that, you know, We the World, there are so many organizations that are doing essentially the same thing we're trying to do. We're you know, and in this Harmony Week, everyone joining hands in a much more powerful way, so that we can collectively have that ripple effect to inspire others to join and to step into their own light, to be able to make those kinds of positive changes that they can, because we all have a gift. We all came here for a reason, and it is about stepping into that power and owning it. And then secondly, I really am excited about the possibility to co-create a mixed reality experience that helps people to navigate the inner space, to really the work that you're doing, to be able to raise our light quotient, all those spiritual tools and technology that we have available to us, and the ancient wisdom, and to infuse this into a multi-dimensional, multi-sensory experience that helps mimic the that type of enlightenment, so that it gives us courage and determination to keep up our spiritual practice on a regular basis, because we get to reap the rewards in this simulated environment that kind of is where we're headed, all of us.
Absolutely, absolutely. So what about one person who's listening right now, who is just sitting on the edge of their seat saying, what do I do next? How can I get involved? What would you give as an action step for somebody who wants to be part of the solution?
Who wants to be part of
the solution, part of being a part of your journey, part of this beautiful vision that you have. Somebody sitting on the edge of their seat, hearing this interview and saying, what can I do to help?
Call me.
And the best way they can get in touch with you, Megan?
Sure. That is the coolest part about, you know, how I feel in my in my journey and where I am today, is that I get to meet the most amazing people.
Yeah.
And and it took a lot for me to start waking up, and I'm, you know, in the process like everyone else, but I really am grateful for the suffering that I've had, because it's brought me to a place where all of a sudden this co-creation is happening all the time, and meeting kind of different people, and how can I support you? And, you know, I feel that with your work, if there's anything I can do to support you, let me know. And that's how it's like co-creation in real time. You don't need, you know, to get a job with that person, with that company. We are all co-creating in this organic, way, which is really the way it's supposed to be. It's very
nice. I like to think of it as kind of like this really fun potluck, you know, and everybody has something that, like, a really awesome salad or really awesome side dish or a really amazing dessert. And some people have like a pretty, really cool entree that they want to bring, that's like really a big entree, you know? Like We the World, you know, and the Compassion Games and Charter for Compassion. They have a really big kind of, wonderful entree. And then there's so many of us who have these delicious side salads and these delicious, ways that we all come together, and we just have this beautiful, beautiful, organic, divine potluck. That's how I see it, you know.
Like a Caesar salad in midair, and we're all part of it. And it's funny, because when I was introduced to John, the person who introduced us, I said, basically, I want to swim with salmon, you know.
Yeah.
It's me and another person, and we want to just be a part of this larger collective doing this similar kind of work. And yeah, however we can contribute, we want to do it.
It's awesome. It's so awesome. Thank you. I want to be mindful of your time. So I want you to just please let people know the best way they can contact you, the best way to connect with you, the best way to reach out to you, so that we can continue this conversation.
Sure. Well, I guess the easiest way would be to go to leadershipfordiversity.com. And I think you're going to share the banner.
Which yes, and your beautiful poem. I'll be sharing that on Sunday, yeah.
Perfect. And then the banner actually has the three things at the top, the kind of the commitment to be a better leader, supporting each other in the process. And if you resonate, just add your name, and then you're a part of it. We have 300 members so far. And then you can send email, and we can connect via Skype or phone. I think that would be the easiest.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Megan. Thank you for being here, and thank you for shining your beautiful light. Keep shining that beautiful light, and keep being that beautiful soul that you are, and shining everywhere into those dark places, because the dark places are really just an illusion. And as we begin to just continue to add to the light and ignore, not ignore, but know that the illusion is the illusion, and really just keep adding to the light, we will start to see these beautiful patterns of perfection starting to take place. And the miscreations that we have made will start to fall away, because this old earth, this old energy of fear is done. And this new energy of endless possibility is so alive and so ready. And it's just all about just playing in this exploration and expansion and this new way of just having hope, having only positive expectations. So thank you, everyone, for being here. And thank you so much for your time, Megan. I so appreciate
it. Karen, I really appreciate it. It was great.